Ladies and gentlemen, we are about to begin our session titled British Council Translation Workshop. Kindly take your seats and either switch off your mobile phones or put them on silent mode. Participants of this session are Taimur Shahid, Durdana Sumro, Nikesh Shukla, Nikita Lalwani, Joya Wirzoni, and Daniel Hahn. The total duration of the session is 60 minutes. We would appreciate if complete silence is observed while the session is in progress. A question and answer session will be held at the end. Please raise your hands and the microphone will be brought to you. Please keep your questions short and precise and refrain from making statements. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, for being here. And this morning we're going to try and discuss all the subtleties of translation and translation work, and especially because we had this amazing workshop 2 days back at Oxford University Press, sponsored by British Council and led by BCLT, British Centre for Literary Translation. So this morning we're trying to understand the mechanisms involved in a workshop, and also talk about translation in general, and also about being a writer, a translated writer. So briefly I'll introduce the panelists. Taimur Shahid, who is an academic, I'm starting from my left, academic, translator, poet, who is actually teaching at LAMS. He's teaching Southeast Asian literatures. Please show your book. It just came out with Zuban in Daily Base publisher. Daniel Hahn, to my left, is a translator, writer, editor. He works from three different languages, I think, Spanish, Portuguese, and French. Nikita Lalwani is a writer based in the UK, born in Rajasthan, I think. And she has two novels, which have been translated in 15 or 16 languages, including Italian. Durdana Sumro is a writer and a translator who was at the workshop with us. And Nikhil Shukla, he's a writer based in the UK as well. And his book, Coconut Unlimited, has not yet been translated, but we would like to know more about what he thinks about future translations of his books. So I would like to start with a few words on the workshop itself, and maybe Daniel could start explaining how the mechanism, how did you come up with the idea of workshops originally also?
Thank you, Joya. Good morning. I'll tell you very briefly how the workshops work and why they work as they do, because it's sort of, in one sense it's very simple, in another sense it's slightly peculiar, I think. Translation is itself a very simple and also a very complicated thing. Translation involves two processes, one of which is reading and one of which is writing. These are the two things that happen. You read this book and then you write this other book, which is somehow the same book but also a completely different book. And in that process, going from the reading to the writing, a million tiny little things are changing. A million tiny little decisions are being made. When I am translating a book, every time I see a word, lots of little things are happening in my head, which will be very different, or at least fractionally different, from what any other person will see in those words. I will hear things slightly differently. I will notice different things. I will like different things. I will then write something, and I will write it in a slightly different way to the way any other translator would. Every translation is going to be slightly personal. And every piece of text is going to have a million little things which I could choose to do or not to do. I was going to ask as an example, Nikesh, can you tell us the first sentence of your of Coconut Unlimited? Do you remember your first sentence?
One summer when I was 9 and Neil was 11, he had a tape.
Hmm. One summer when I was 9 and Neil was 11, he had a tape. In that sentence, there is some data, there is some information, but there is also voice, and there is rhythm, and there is register, and there is the fact that it ends with the word tape, which tells you lots of things about the time, and it tells you lots of things about the voice, and the rhythm is very distinctive, and the diction is very distinctive. So it's not just information. And so when I'm writing something, if I were translating that into some other language, I would have to be alert to all of those things. What we do in the workshop is essentially two things, both of which are designed to make the process as complicated as possible, which essentially is to slow down the translation process, first of all, so that you can see all of these little decisions being made. And secondly, to require a lot of people to sit around a table and produce a translation which is consensual. So in spite of the fact that everyone would translate in different ways and everyone would have different preferences and different ways of rendering, as it were, that sentence of Nikesh's, what we make people do is find a way of articulating their thoughts and therefore come to a consensus translation. So we will have 10 people around a table, and they will, between them, try to find a way of translating, in theory, a story. In practice, you never get very far because it's a very slow process. Nikesh's sentence is maybe a dozen words. In our workshops, that might take 10 minutes, it might take an entire morning, because you've slowed the process down so much that you can see, you can argue about every word, you can argue about every piece of punctuation. That sentence could have a comma in it, it could have two commas, it could have no commas. In the translation, you might try and decide, you might make decisions on that level. So at the workshops, we essentially get groups of people to try and produce at a very, very kind of relentlessly, irritatingly slow pace to try and produce a consensus translation on the assumption that looking at something in that much detail and looking at something with that kind of rigor and articulating those things is a way of making you understand what is happening in the process. Just briefly, the other thing we do to make things a little bit more complicated is we usually have the author of the text in the room with the workshop, and I can see one of our authors with us today. I'm delighted he's with us. One of the things that happens is when you're reading a text as a translator, you are constantly asking these questions. You're interrogating the text, trying to figure out what's happening with a word, with a line. Why this word? Why is there a comma here? And so in our workshops, having the author present means that you're not doing this in an abstract way. You can actually say to the unfortunate author who is sitting in the room, well, why did you use this word, and why is this, and what exactly are you trying to do? So the workshop is also based not only on this very, very slow and very careful and demanding and, I think, fascinating consensus translation. It also, one of the things that distinguishes it is having a writer in the room who can help you to unpick what is happening in the original text, which then will inform the way in which you can assemble your translation.
Yes, and of course, it's a kind of a luxury situation, because we could see, I was an observer, and I could see the two different workshop. I mean, of course, we were too many to have one group, so the group was split up in two. And I was just wondering, because of course we were kind of the troublemakers. We would walk in, me and Daniel, and you know, just try to say why did you put this, and why? Because it is basically, the point is to slow the process at, you know, the maximum. And it is a luxury, because nobody, I mean, no translator can take the luxury of, you know, spending 6 hours on a single word unless they want to be very poor for the rest of their lives. So I just wanted to ask Tamur and Durdana what they thought, maybe Tamur first, what was their impression of the workshop, and if they noticed some peculiar process in their own group.
Thank you. I'll pick up from where Dan left. You know, it being a very slow process. Can you hear me?
Hmm.
Yeah. So to give you an example of how slow it is, the first line of her story, I guess most of you will understand Urdu, is Jeep chal rahi thi. And it took us about 1.5 hour to come to a translation of that sentence. And we finally agreed upon the Jeep was moving. Sounds fairly simple, right? And it was about 10 people in the room, including the author, who spent like 1.5 hour fighting and discussing about a translation of this fairly simple present continuous sentence, which was in fact translated into 10 different renditions by 10 different people. So this actually is what happens on an individual level as well, because most of the times translations are done privately. I mean, when you know you don't have an interlocutor that you can engage with about these questions. But the task of the workshop was to sort of become conscious of these questions and these choices that we make. And if such a simple sentence like this can take so long, I mean, that is of course not to discourage you from doing translations, because after a while you get used to it, and when you're doing it on your own, you won't take too long, and there will be solutions and answers to questions which you can just reuse. But then there are problems like localisms in certain languages. There are problems like vocatives and accents, right? How do you translate, for example, abe or are, or how do you translate are bap, and things like these, which are very, very sort of specific to the language, if not to the culture. And also, I mean, these are in fact, I would say, minor issues. There are things like which are sort of conceptual, structural differences in languages. I mean, there are syntactical differences. When Urdu is written, for example, if you're translating from Urdu, something that is peculiar is that the tense varies immensely. You can go into a different tense within the same sentence. You can use like 5 different tenses within a paragraph. But you can't do that in English. If English you start with, I was going, and then you say, I had gone in the second line when you're referring back to it, it wouldn't work. But Urdu can do it. So how do you render these things? I mean, you always lose something of the original. So one of the things that I think that we learned from the workshop was that, you know, you have to learn to lose a few things. You have to learn to be able to sort of write in the language of your audience. And you have to actually give up the text. And you have to, you know, sort of assume that the author is dead. I mean, and after you have done the translation, you are dead too. Because then the text becomes an independent sort of entity which the reader can read in whatever way. And if your reader, if you know, if your audience is somebody which does not know the original text, then your translation, if it is trying to be too faithful, it wouldn't work. I think you know, these are, other than these sort of syntactical grammatical differences, there are also things which are sort of conceptually different, and which I think one of the good things about translation is it teaches you, it sort of opens up your cognition, I think. I mean, for example, in Urdu, you use this phrase all the time, and I mean, this is my sort of pet example, which I think is almost, I haven't been able to come up with a translation, it's untranslatable in English, I mean, conceptually, is that, mujhe yaad mat aao. Now, this is a simple sort of sentence, but in which literally, it just means that, you know, I'm missing you, I don't want to, but then the burden, and I miss you, sort of English. The verb miss is being sort of the object is somebody. I mean, the subject of the verb is I, right? I mean, I am doing the missing. But in Urdu, even though I am missing, the verb, the subject of the verb is somebody else. The person who you are missing is actually the person who is performing the verb while you are experiencing it. So how do you capture that sort of conceptual difference? And this is sort of possibly, you know, I don't know, translatable in certain languages. In French, in Italian. In French, it's possible to do it. But in English, you cannot. And that's why I also believe, I think, Urdu poetry is actually translated much better in French than in English, because of these sort of conceptual differences. But what it does to you, it sort of makes you conscious of these things, of these sort of conceptual categories, which determine how you live as a human being, how you experience life. Even though, I mean, you know, so your life is, I guess, governed by the language that you speak, the language that you live in, the language that you read. So these things, I think, I mean, other than just like the practical aspect, translation is something which will also make you self-conscious, make you aware of new things, and it's quite a wonderful process.
Talking about the process and the workshop, I wanted to ask Durdana if she thinks that her group managed to actually get rid of the original text and grow up and become an independent text in those few hours, because that's the aim of it. Do you think you managed to?
Well, for me, and I think for most of our group, is my microphone working?
Yeah.
So the very unusual thing was to have our author Hassan Manzar present with us. Sorry. For us, the unusual thing was to have the author Hassan Manzar present while we were doing the translation, and we started off with the discussion about whether we could leave the text behind and, you know, feel a bit free to be creative with it or not. And I think one of our group said it very nicely when he said that you know, a song can be sung in so many different ways, you know, and it's the same song, but it's sung in different ways, so it has a different resonance, you know. And I think Taimur has been very, has gone into the whole process very nicely, and I think that we all felt the same way I think we understood how this translation was going to be done and everything, and that it was really to slow it down and to get people to understand how it works. And it was fascinating to see it sort of happening live on the screen, because where we were sitting, there were screens all around the room, and you could actually see the translation taking shape, you know, and that was a very interesting thing, because anybody who was passing could say, see, you know, okay, so that's the first sentence, and then that's the second sentence, and it's just happening there, you know, live. And a live translation was quite unusual. But I think for me also, I had the whole part of it being a consensus translation was very, it was something which doesn't happen quite often. And in fact, when I mentioned it to people, and they were very surprised that we could, take one text and 10 people or 11 people would do the translation jointly. And I got a lot of, comments like, oh, too many cooks spoil the broth, and, you know, things like that. But in fact, although we didn't do much either, we just out of, I think it was a 6.5 page story. And in those two intensive days, which were from like 10 to 5, we only managed to do 2.5 pages. But still, I felt that we had done a good job, you know, and we were all very happy and satisfied with it. And even though every time you read a translation, you can change something and you feel that it's for the better. But to me, it showed me the value of a consensus translation. And I feel that in Pakistan, there are so many, you know, even to make our own local, literature accessible to Pakistanis, sometimes a consensus translation can be very good, you know, like when you have Balochi literature or Sindhi literature or Pashto literature, and maybe you don't have people who have, the mastery over the source language as well as the target language, then to do it in a consensus form would be, on a consensus platform would be very good. And secondly, when you want to do it, from Pakistani literature to some, world literature, you know, like if you want to translate something from Urdu, say, to German, then you may not have an Urdu speaker who is fluent in German, but you could have an Urdu speaker and an English speaker and a German speaker and do the translation in one sitting. And like, for example, I have a very good friend who is fluent in German and in French and in Portuguese. And we had, were trying to do a translation of a German text into English. So she would put it into a sort of like, a, you know, her own sort of broken English. And then I would sort of, you know, we would discuss and I would put it into, you know, an English sort of, you know, I would just polish it up. And that project didn't take off, but I thought that consensus translation would be ideal for this kind of situation where you don't have to wait for something to be translated into a, you know, into English before it can be translated into something else. And, you know, I think BCLT with its expertise and its experience could, you know, I mean, could guide and direct some, you know, initiatives in that direction as well.
Of course, ideally we would have, I mean, workshop should last at least a year because that would be ideal. But
just lock people in a room until the book is finished.
Exactly. But basically, I mean, to me, translation is learning the art of losing, and it's a good lesson in life as well, and it's a very slow process, and at the beginning, you don't want to lose anything, and then you learn, like Elizabeth Bishop's beautiful poem on the art of losing, which it's very scary, and it sounds like a disaster, but then it's not. I can't remember it. Do you remember the war?
The art of losing isn't hard to master.
Yeah, so it sounds like a disaster, but it's not. So from the point of view of a writer, and then when you think that your book is going to be out and you kind of lose any control on your words because somebody else is taking care of it, is it scary? Is it thrilling? I want to ask Nikesh first and then Nikita. Are you scared of your book being translated into French or some Italian would mess up the whole thing or not?
It would be really interesting. I'd love to see what they would do with it because a lot of my work depends on
language,
slang and language. And I'm, without sounding too pretentious, I'm from a hip-hop background. So I had delusions of wanting to be a rapper when I was 21 years old. And when I failed at that, I decided to use the rhythms of rap in literature. And so a lot of what I do is very rhythmical. And it'll be interesting to see how you would retain the rhythms in different languages. Because how I write is I write it, and then I speak it, and I speak it, and I speak it, and then I rewrite it, and then I speak it, and I speak it, and I speak it, and then I rewrite it. And so a lot of it is the interplay between the page and the performance and the voice, just so I can get the rhythms right.
The thing.
Huh?
Is it this microphone?
Loud, more loud.
I'm not having luck with microphones today. Yeah. The microphone only ever seems to come back in when I'm complaining that the microphone's not working. So yeah, I just said loads of stuff about hip-hop. And that's
one of the things you might find there, which is, I think, sort of to do with what Joya was saying about loss, is when you're translating, you're always, as I said, choosing what to privilege and what to choose. You might find that someone translating you into, say, Italian, in order to keep things like rhythm, might have to, I don't know, change the names of your characters. That actually, there may be certain things that seem quite fundamental that would have to change in order to keep something which actually may be more important. Maybe that the rhythm is much more important than a place name or than a particular piece of actual narrative. And in order to keep the rhythm, you have to the translator would have to compromise on things that may seem quite basic to a writer, I think.
And also, it'd be interesting to see the sort of exchange of idioms and the exchange of slang as well, I think.
Yeah, it's like in my experience, I remember when I was translating Canon Jones, this Welsh writer, and he uses a very sparse, very clipped prose. So I was thinking maybe your prose would be as challenging because Italian is a very slow... I always imagine Italian as a big, fat, bejeweled lady walking slowly and decadent, maybe aristocratic, and using these extremely long words and polysyllables everywhere. And then you have this...
It's very not clipped, isn't it, Italian?
No. And then you have English, and especially that book I was working on was like, all the words were so short and you had to find the equivalent and monosyllables, bisyllables maximum. So you had to basically work on that kind of rhythm because and choose very short and clipped word to keep that tempo, that music.
But I think that's why the English language works. What really well in sort of iambic pentameter because
exactly.
It has, you can use that interplay between the short words to create the boom, boom, boom,
rhythm. And you can do it. I mean, it's just harder, but it's possible. And Nikita's been translating to 16 languages, so I don't think she could be possessive because you wouldn't sleep at night if you were like if you're paranoid, then it's too much.
Well, I think it's a great privilege to be translated, but one of the things that might help that is the fact that I can't fully and in a relaxed way read most of the translations myself, which is probably quite common for many writers. So, for example, even though I speak Hindi, it's been translated into Hindi and Marathi and Malayalam and other Indian languages. I can speak Hindi, but I'm not great at reading the cursive script. So I can read it, but like a child of 7 or 8 years old, you know. So I'll read it very slowly, and then I'll think, oh, this is quite tiring. And I can't just sit down and read the French translation, even though I can speak French. I can't read it. So that protects you on one level. But I do know that the titles are different in most of those translations. Mm-hmm. So coming back to something fundamental, like a title, you think a title is fundamental to the book if you're attached to the title. So just some examples, Gifted. So the first, my first novel is about a maths genius, she's called, who's a young child who's very good at maths, who's Indian growing up in Wales. And I called it The Square Root. That was my title for it. My editor changed that to Gifted. So you're already used to being edited, meaning being changed,
losing
straight away. And you have to accept that if you want to be published and if you want it to be the best book it can be. It's an ongoing dialogue. And then Gifted, I became attached to. And then the translation starts. And so in Italian, the translation is La Bambina Prodigio. So that's the prodigious child or the child prodigy. In Hindi, it's Pinjar Ka Udar, which is the flight of the bird or something like that.
Completely.
The bird flies. Mm. Or is it the cage of the bird? Does anyone know? I can't remember now. Fudar is... Pinjara, yeah. Bird cage, that's right. Yeah, that's right, the bird cage. Because I'm thinking I know why the cage bird sings. Right. It made me think of the Maya Angelou book. but I quite liked it, Pinjar Ka Udar. I thought that sounds like a film. Maybe Amir Khan will adapt it for me. Pinjar Ka Udar, Tara Jameen Pir, it could be like that. And then in Spain, it was called Raíces Cuadradas, Square Roots. So they took my original title that was rejected by my editor. Uh-huh. They must have written to me and said, do you have any other titles because we don't like Gifted? So the Square Root. But they changed it to Square Roots, which is totally different. It's totally different because the square root is a square root of a number. She's square. In the UK, square means that you're not cool, you're a geek. So to be square is to not be straight, not to be smart. So the square root, you know, is a wordplay. Square roots, what's that? Something weird. Anyway, the list goes on, but I'm not attached as much. Oh, in France, it's surdoué. Surdoué. So, especially gifted, especially talented. It means talented, actually. Talented, I remember that. So, I realized then that I wasn't precious just as this started happening. I just felt excited to see how they would interpret it, excited that another language, another country wanted to own it. In Polish, it is utalentowana, which I think is gifted again. So I felt an excitement to see if something fresh or an interpretation could be brought to the text, just like you might if a scriptwriter writes a film about your book, because it needs to be a script, it needs to be something new.
I don't know how much time we have for Q&A.
We still have a half an hour.
Okay, good. Do you want to add something or?
Go ahead.
No, I wanted to ask, for instance, and it's probably interesting for the audience, Daniel, how is it to be in touch with the writers you work on, and if it's easier to be in touch, or if you're working on classics, you can't write an email, and is it liberating? How is it?
That depends very much. There are some writers who, my favorite kind of writer to work with is a writer who has two properties. One is they are alive and on email and responsive. And the other property, which is rarer, is that they have some understanding of what translation is. So to deal with a writer who says, but I want it to be called gifted. And you say, but gifted doesn't work in my language, because in my language you don't have these two meanings. You can either call it talented, or you can call it someone who has been given something, but it doesn't work in any other way. And then they say, but I want it to be called gifted.
Yeah.
So the writers who really understand what's happening in the process, who can be protective in one sense, but can also be generous and can be open, those are the sort of ideal writers. And I've been very lucky that most of my writers are on email, and they are not control freaks completely. There are, I mean, every translator I know has stories about writers who think their English is better than the translator's English, and as a result want to make decisions about this piece of English writing based on some vague idea that, you know, they spent a summer in Chicago when they were 17, and they therefore think that this qualifies them to be a writer of English, which isn't quite true. But when you have a relationship with a writer whom you trust and who really trusts you, this is the other thing, you're asking them to trust you to write a book for them, which is going to have their name on it. I mean, I kind of think it's almost like saying, what's going to happen now is we're going to get someone else who's going to paraphrase Coconut Unlimited in English. Someone else is going to write it, but using all different words. But it's going to be in English. It's going to have your name on it. I hope you're okay with that. You're going to have to trust me. It isn't a huge thing to ask someone to
do. Where do I sign?
Yeah, excellent. Well, in that case, we shall do that. I shall translate you into some other English. But it is kind of tantamount to that. And I think, in a sense, what Nikita was saying is really important, that it is quite valuable having a writer who can't read or can't completely read the translation, because they then don't feel quite so constrained by the things that they can see, by the gaps between the two things, because there will always be gaps.
They just feel grateful that they were translated, don't they, usually?
Yes, though you may feel less grateful if you could actually read Korean. You may suddenly discover that there's a terrible travesty being perpetrated upon your work, a violence being perpetrated upon your work, and your name is on the cover. But I'm sure this is not the case. But I think if you have a writer with whom you have that kind of level of trust, it can be a very rewarding relationship. I'm very close friends to people I've translated over the last few years, because you need that trust. And because you're working, even if you never meet, you're working in a funny way very intensively together. When I translate a writer, there's one person I'm about to start translating the fifth book we've done together. So I've spent a sizable proportion of the last 6 years living inside his brain, which is a fairly intimate arrangement. I've spent quite a lot of time trying to sound like him and trying to work out what he's thinking. It's a little bit sinister when I describe it like that. It's slightly, you know, talented Mr. Ripley or something. It's not quite like that. But there is a degree of intimacy which it encourages if it goes well. It's also one of the reasons why if it goes badly, it goes badly quite dramatically, because again, if the trust is broken, if the writer feels like somehow the translator is producing something which is a travesty of what they're trying to do, or conversely, the translator feels translators are as aggrieved, as easily aggrieved in this process as the writers, I should say, feels that the writer is somehow being obstructive. Again, the stakes feel quite high in that relationship.
And also, and also decision. I mean, if you're working with a living writer, fine, you have email, you can get in touch. But of course, I remember in my case, years ago, I was translating Paula Fox. I think I was telling this in Lums and Lahore. I was translating Paula Fox. It was one of those very difficult books, and she's 86 something, and she was very fast on email. I mean, she would reply no problem. But because it was a very complicated book, and it was one of those books full of dilemmas and decisions to take, and I couldn't send an email every 2 seconds. I remember I had this very vivid dream at night, more of a nightmare, that Paula Fox was pulling my left arm, and a reader, an obscure, faceless reader, was pulling the other hand. I was like, but that never happened after. I mean, I suppose over the years you kind of get over that kind of panic. But
it's almost like a lover relationship.
Exactly. Though. Because yes, and so I wanted to ask, you work more with classics, so what are the other challenges, or you know, when, if you can't ask any question to the writer, what happens, how many decisions you, I mean, you have to take more decisions, of course.
Well, I mean, I have both of my books that I've translated. I mean, the authors were dead before I was born.
Exactly.
So I think, I mean, the question of gaps, you know, and what you were also getting at with having a different sort of a title. And how I deal with it is, I mean, I actually think about it much more critically than just sort of a choice in terms of craft. And, you know, and I try to think of it philosophically. What is sort of the task of the author, and then what is the task of the translator? And I think one of the people who have helped me think through this is Walter Benjamin, you know, a wonderful German critic who has this essay called The Task of the Translator. And I think it really sort of, it's, you know, he's a theological theory about what the task of the translator is, in which he is interpreting Genesis chapter 1 verses 1 to 11, where the story of the Tower of Babel, where all humanity was one and they were gathered at one place, they spoke one language, and then just because of the fact that they spoke one language, they could have achieved reality, and they could have sort of grasped whatever reality there was. I mean, you know, to put it in very sort of crude way, but then sort of God decided that to muddle their speech, and henceforth languages were born. And from one sort of common language, humanity was divided into different sort of people who spoke different languages. And for him, Benjamin, you know, the task of the translator is actually to sort of go back to that ideal state where you live in the Tower of Babel. So even though it is not possible to sort of achieve that one language, the task of the translator is to sort of bridge that gap between languages, you know, to sort of capture that reality. So the task becomes much more easier, right? The idea is not to literally translate something that is already there, because that's one glimpse of reality. What you are translating into is another glimpse of reality, which is creating something more, something bigger. So it's much easier to lose, right? It's much easier to sort of, because then you have a sense of sort of purpose, that you are doing something much larger than just sort of capturing something that is already there, because you're creating something new. And translation, really, I mean, the text itself is a completely new entity. I mean, it's a new task, and in many ways, I mean, I write as well. I mean, I write poetry, but translating poetry has taught me that it's in many ways translation is much more difficult than sort of writing your own, because you're constrained by things that you wouldn't be when you're writing. You can still, I mean, even though you're trying to sort of capture something else, but still there are things you know, which you cannot do. I mean, and again, this sort of question of losing, right? The learning the art of losing. It's also reminded me of another poem by Jack Gilbert called The Lost Hotels of Paris, right? And he starts, the first line is, "The Lord gives everything and charges by taking it back," right? And then he goes on, it's beautiful, and it ends by saying, you know, the sort of sense of loss of everything. And then he says, "And that too is more than enough." So once, I mean, I think that's a sort of a useful thing for a translator to sort of realize, and even for authors who sort of want to be translated, to sort of realize that the task of the author and the translator is to capture, I mean, because if, you know, the task of the author is to capture something, whatever the author is trying to do, some form of reality, the same is the task of the translator as well. In terms of, you know, just briefly mentioning about classics, I think
the most difficult part is to capture the register, right? Because if you're translating, I mean, this book is a 19th century text, and it's supposed to be a novella, but half of it is poetry. I mean, literally narrative poetry. Mm. Now, how do you capture that, right? And it's a register which is difficult even in contemporary Urdu-speaking world for people to sort of read. And people, nobody speaks like that anymore, right? It's an affected register. And nobody speaks in narrative poetry either. So how do you capture that? Mm. I mean, and that's where I think the question of your audience becomes really fundamentally important. I mean, in English, narrative poems, long narrative poems, wouldn't work as a novel. So we decided, I mean, this is a co-translation, so we decided to sort of render it into prose. I mean, this is a decision that we had to take. So we lost that form, we lost that sort of certain metrical structure of that was there in Urdu, but then you try to capture that in some other way to make it more sort of lyrical. And about the question of register, I mean, yeah, what do you want to use biblical language if you're translating a classical text from Persian, for example, which has been written like 500 years ago, because the register would be closer to what the biblical register is. What do you do? And I think one good example is Musharraf Ali Faruqi, who is a wonderful Urdu translation, his translation of The Adventures of Amir Hamza, which is a classical text, but it's a brilliant translation. But then the reader has to struggle with it, even in English. The Urdu, you have to read it with a dictionary. In English too, you have to go to like Samuel Johnson, or you have to go to biblical dictionaries in order to be able to understand most of the things. But then it is impossible for him to translate it in any other way, because those are the things that the original text contains. So it's a difficult balance, I guess. I haven't really ever worked with the author. With any author. In fact, I have. In terms of poetry, Afzal Saab, he's here. He's a wonderful poet, and I realized that you know, sometimes it is useful, but sometimes it is like, oh, I was reading the poem completely differently. Hmm. So what do you do there, right? I mean, it's a poem which you can interpret in two ways. Now he says, well, this is what it meant, but then for me, really, I mean, if I read it a certain way and another reader is reading a certain way, which is the authorial version. I mean, as soon as the author writes something and publishes it, I think really the author is gone, no more. Mm-hmm. So for me, I would rather just, I mean, take some advice. Sometimes it is helpful, mm-hmm. but not haggle too much with the author.
Because basically the whole thing is a big project. That's what we were discussing a few days ago. It is really like building something. So all the decisions enter a larger scheme of things that we do it naturally. I mean, I don't sit down and take notes and think, oh, which kind of register will I use now? Which is something that happens in your head without you noticing. But things like the deciding a register or a tone come naturally in fiction. In poetry, for me, is extremely scary, and it requires more planning, I think. So I just wanted to ask Turdana, and what she feels about, you know, when she writes her own things, and what's the difference between being a writer and a translator, and do you feel like that's the other major question in that translators are asked? Do you feel as a co-author? I never felt as a co-author, because I think in a way we have a path to follow, and we have some things we can grasp to, which could be grammar, which could be plot, which could be syntax. But so what do you think about this co-author or versus
the book that I had co-authored? So it was not that, it was that, you know, each chapter was done by a different person. Like, I mean, so I did one chapter, I did like say 10 chapters, and the other author did 10 chapters, you know. And so then when it was edited, it was put together to make it like a whole. But definitely, I think if you are writing yourself as a writer, you are much freer to write whatever you want. But as I think somebody said here, that as a translator, you are constrained by the writer of the original text. You know, you can't. You feel a responsibility as well to your the author, that you don't want to take. You want the text to be readable and accessible to the target audience, but you don't want to take so many liberties that, you know, it is, doesn't have any connection with the original text. But I wanted to talk about the title, you know, which Nikita had mentioned, that very often the title is not something which is, you know, it passes out of the translator's hands and it goes into the marketing department. So, you know, they couldn't care less what the title is, but it's something which should sell, you know. And I mean, like Bapsi Sidhwa wrote The Crow Eaters, it was in English, but when it was published in America, it had a different title, wasn't it? I don't remember the title, but I know that it was published with a different title, even though she had written it in English, so there was no question of changing the title. And, you know, I've written a lot of journalism I've done, and, you know, you could submit your article with the best title that you had thought of and a really catchy one, but when it would come printed in the newspaper, it would have quite a different title altogether. And, you know, that was something which they felt was more suitable or, you know, was more sort of attention getting or whatever. And so I think that one has to, even the author has to sort of, you know, give up a bit, you know, agree to give up.
Yeah. Also the question of, like, for instance, if a translator for some reason rewrites your novel, what would you? Because that could happen. You could end up with a translator that kind of changes things at his, I mean,
no,
could.
Never.
Yes, let's never. Let's
going to lose his faith in translators.
No?
You might be edited as well.
That's good. It was a bad question, so they're cutting me off. No, it was kind of science fiction, but you know, I always think, like, what would they think?
Freak out a little bit.
Exactly. No, but that's why authors should be...
Proceed?
Yes. No, authors should be perfectly aware of what translation entails, and they should force their publisher to treat us very well, right?
We've talked a lot about, celebrating translation, which is obviously really great, but it'll be really good if you guys could tell us about some of the difficulties that you sometimes face, like how easy is it to translate things like comedy, which is obviously very different from country to country, continent to continent, and have you ever got it wrong? Not being on the spot.
Well, I don't believe I'm the one holding the microphone when you said, "Have you ever got it wrong?" I, of course, have never got it wrong. But I'm told that there are some translators who do occasionally. No one present, of course, ever got it wrong. Well, things like comedy are interesting because a lot of it does come down to your relationship to the author in a funny way. Because I think one of the things that should make it easier, sort of relating to what I said earlier, is a good relationship between. Which is also your way of making sure that we don't do anything outrageous to your book and change the ending if we happen not to like the ending. One of the great benefits, if you have access to a living author and it's not a living author who is a crazy person, one of the benefits of having access to a living author as opposed to translating a classic, I think I feel much freer when I need to be free, and for things like comedy you have to be quite free. With a living author, I will very frequently send an email saying, so this joke at the end of chapter 6, not funny in English. I'm going to have to make a new one. I'm going to have to construct a joke which has the same moving parts, because your joke depends on someone hearing this word and thinking that they've heard that word. But these two words are not the same in the language I'm translating into, so I'm going to need to figure out what the moving parts of this joke, and I'm going to have to build a new joke. Now, I will do that if I can write to an author who's a friend of mine and say, you understand why the joke is going to be about something slightly different. You know, I have not that long ago written to an author and said, you know that thing about chickens in your book? They're going to have to be parrots. You have to just trust me. I'll explain if you want to know why, but I'm just going to have to do that. That's something which, if I were translating someone who was dead or to whom I had no access for some reason, I would be much warier about changing that kind of thing. So I think in a funny way, having a writer sort of looking over your shoulder can give you a kind of license. A friend of mine was translating a book by a fantastic Argentine writer, Julio Cortázar, and she had a trouble with a pun, and she sent an email around to her friend and said, what do I do with this joke? And we all suggested things, and we all created our terribly clever plays on words, did as best, you know, best we could. And she wrote back and said, well, if I could get his permission, I would do that. But Cortázar has been dead for quite a long time and therefore doesn't answer my emails, and so there's nothing much I can do. And I think in a funny way, having a writer there, even though I agree that the writer is not ceases to be the ultimate arbiter of anything once the book is in the world, I think you can feel having a writer who will condone things can actually be quite useful. So when you're talking about something like comedy, when you're talking about something which does require a particular degree of creativity or delinquency, depending on how you look at it, I think actually having that sort of relationship with a writer who will condone this outrageous behaviour does allow you to do things which are much more dynamic and much suppler and much cleverer, and will ultimately make your book funnier in English.
I can give an example from Urdu that, Ibn Safi has a very peculiar sense of humor. He has created this character, Imran, who is a goofy guy, but he's the intelligence chief. He's the most intelligent person in his novels, right? So, but he has a very goofy humor. So he's meeting this guy, he's investigating a murder, and then one of the guys has something to tell him. And then when he meets him, the guy is hesitant because he's realized this is not a stupid person, but an intelligence agent. And he says, "Ke ek baat hai, main aapko bata to doon, par aap mera mazak udayenge." And Imran says in reply, "Ke kyun uske par hain?" And he's like, "What? To phir kya kehte? To phir main kaise udaunga?" Now, if you literally translate it into English, it's like, you know, I'll have something to tell you, but you will make fun of me. But make fun in English is like, in Urdu is like, you know, to fly fun. He's like, "Oh, I'll tell you something, but you'll fly fun." And then he says, "Well, that, why does it have wings?" Right? That sort of humor. How do you translate that? I deliberated on it for a long time, and you know, the solution that I came up with, I don't know if it's wrong or right, was like, you know, "I have something to tell you, but you will brush it aside." And then he says, "Why does it have hair?" It's not exactly making fun, but the sort of the sense is achieved, and you know, and the sort of humor, the kind of humor on the wordplay is achieved. So sometimes you're able to do that. Sometimes you cannot. So you know, I guess being able to talk to the author is consoling and reassuring. But it's all right.
I have a question for you, because you write your own poetry as well, and you're do you ever feel like changing it just to make it better? So in that example you gave, you made a decision about what was the important part of that sentence. There are two things that were going on in the sentence. One thing is it being funny, and one thing is the image of him coming back on the simile or the metaphor. And you decided that the coming back on the image was more important than the humor, because brush it aside isn't as funny or... shall I use that instead?
Yeah.
Oh, it's working again. Because one of my favorite scenes we were talking about in translation is by Javier Marías, the Spanish writer. And he's got a really wonderful scene that really inspired me for my last novel's got a translator in it, The Village. And in this scene, Javier Marías has got a person who is probably Margaret Thatcher, although she's never named as Margaret Thatcher, and another world leader who's, I think, Gorbachev, but not named as Gorbachev. And there are two translators, and they don't like what's going on between Thatcher and Gorbachev. They don't like the tension and aggression and the way the world could go. It could go wrong. This meeting could screw up the world. And they also fancy each other, the two translators, so there's a flirtation between them. So they introduce flirtation into Thatcher and Gorbachev. So they start to make Thatcher flirt with Gorbachev by translating her incorrectly. It's so wonderful, it's joyous. So they make her go, "Oh, but, you know, there's a line, something like, but why don't we, you know, just think about this for a while, you're such a nice person." And they start changing it, and Thatcher's thinking, "Oh, he's coming round, oh, and he's looking at me, like," and he's being complimented, and he thinks, "Oh, she fancied, I've never felt that vibe from her before." And it's really wonderful, and I just wondered, do you ever feel like doing that, because if you're a writer, there's a level of arrogance that requires becoming a writer. You have to be arrogant on one level to put your words down. So do you ever just read it and think, it's not great, I could just...
Well, I think the two things. I mean, there's some, you have to be humble, right? You have to check yourself. Choices become easier for me, again, you know, going back to think of them sort of in a more philosophical sense. I think of writing as translation as well, or even when we're speaking, right? I mean, you're saying something, but I'm interpreting, I'm translating what you are saying into how I understand language and understanding it. And even when I'm writing poetry, right, I'm translating my emotions, my thought, or whatever idea that I have into language. So language itself is something which is inaccurate. It's an idiom. It's a medium of, you know, that to capture reality or whatever, or truth or whatever you want to call it. So in that sense, you're already translating, and even when you're talking, you're already translating in a sort of a broader sense. So it becomes easier to sort of make those choices, which might feel like that they're making things better. Again, you know, well, I'm creating something new. But I don't know about, again, you have to be careful. Like, for example, in Ibn Safi, there's not a very strong tradition in Urdu of editing. So again, the same Ibn Safi novel that I was telling about, the first line is, it's about an American who is visiting this part of the world. And he's describing the guy, you know, is American, he's roaming around in the streets. And then he goes on to something else, and then he comes back about talking about him, that, you know, he's the son of this business tycoon, and he's this and he's that. So now when you translate it into English, it's a little jarring that he sort of, in the same paragraph, he's talking about something, and then he goes into something else, and he comes back to it. And he's not doing it stylistically, you can tell that. He's only doing it because, you know, he's writing this novel in a month and just publishing it, and there's no editor, there's no editorial tradition. So what do you do in English? Well, I made that choice. I mean, again, it was helpful for me to have a mentor, Musharraf Ali Farooqi. He was like, this doesn't work. You know, just edit it out. Just change the order of the sentences so that the description of the American is in one place and then something else. So, yeah.
Can I just add something? Because he made a very important point. We are, as translators, we are revised by editors, luckily. We can't really just... That was provocative, but we can't really change anything unless it's a very clever choice. But there is people that are actually, I mean, we're always checked by somebody who is either working in the publishing house or outsourced editorial services. So there is, of course, a limit to our freedom, but also we are asked, I never do it, why don't you make it better? You know, like, things like that. And it could happen. You know, why don't you... This part is a bit, you know, slow. This, like, paragraph is sloppily written, make it better. You know, that's fairly common.
Yeah, I agree with Taimur that a lot of the Urdu publishing here is not, you know, edited properly and all that. So sometimes the translator may feel that, well, you know, this is an error here or something, I should correct it. And I suppose that when it's a literary translation, one has to be very careful, you know, to make those changes. But I really feel that the translated, what you have translated, should stand on its own, you know. So it should be good enough for somebody to read and not to say, oh, well, this is a translation. I think I would rather read the original. So the translation should be good enough, you know, to stand on its own. That is what I feel.
Because what you want to happen is you want Nikita to read Javier Marias and not notice that what you were reading was that scene mediated by a woman called Margaret Jill Costa, who is sitting quietly in the background and you don't notice her. That you want to feel like it's like what you're getting is completely Javier Marias' joke.
What do you feel when you read Javier Marias, generally?
I think we've been carried away and we only have time for two questions. So, sorry, we were just being excited about talking about... Yes?
Short question. Whose idea is it to translate any subject? Does it come from a writer or does the publishing house come up with this idea? And the other thing is, does translation pay?
Ha
Joy and I will certainly have different perspectives on the second question. The answer to the first is publishers always decide. because publishers are going to be, I mean, not always, but almost always decide, they're almost always going to be the people paying for it. They are usually going to be the people who find a book and decide they want to translate it and approach us. Now, they can make the decision sometimes based on our recommendation. I can go to a publisher and say, I found this fantastic Brazilian novel, you should publish it. But they are then the ones who are going to have to pay for it,
get the rights,
pay me, pay for marketing. And that is sometimes a very difficult conversation to have, because I understand if I go to a publisher and say, here is this wonderful Brazilian novel, I think you should spend £10,000 on it, but you can't read it. You have to trust me, because until I've translated it, by which point it's too late, you won't actually know what it says. So there is, I understand why publishers are reluctant. About how well it pays, in the UK, not everyone in the UK will agree with this, I think it pays quite well. However, there isn't a huge amount of work, so it is quite hard for a lot of people to make a living, because if you can do 4 books a year, which I think for a kind of straightforward novel is fine, 4 or 5 books a year, if they're not massively long or massively difficult, you can make quite a good living. There isn't enough work for everyone who wants to do it to do that many books. We also are fortunate that the rate we get, which is calculated per word, is much higher than almost anywhere in the world. So if there is enough work, then it's not hard to make a living.
Competition is incredible. There's no specific standards of, I mean, we don't have a real association where you can basically, anyone can say, oh, I'm a good translator and I want to. And if the publisher is not a very good publisher, they would go to this person and say, I'll give you these peanuts and be happy, you'll have a bigger CV and so. There is no rules so far. We're trying to build them up, but it's a very slow process, although we translate a lot. And so there, it's basically, you can make a living, you have to be careful, but...
I think one of the reasons is because the translations have much less readership because of the same fact, what we were discussing, the translations are considered somehow inferior to something that is authentic, something that is original, and something that is pure. And as long as it is, you know, sort of the market thinks that way, it is going to be difficult, because, you know, publishers work by selling their books, and if people are not reading them, thinking that, oh, whatever, translation doesn't work, then so you won't get paid.
One more, I think. Yes.
What I was wondering was that essentially we're talking about fiction here. Hmm. But if you move into another genre, like, I'm not talking about school textbooks or college textbooks, but if you move into something like letters or histories or memoirs or autobiographies that people have written, do the rules for translation and editing then change? Or do we still have that same leeway, creative license, that when you're translating fiction, you generally get to keep? You know, that same decision-making process.
I think it depends what... this is a terrible answer. It depends on the text. And it depends on what is important about the text. If it's a work of history where actually a lot of what matters is the voice, then you don't mess with the voice. On the other hand, in a work of history, you don't change the names of the characters, if you were messing around with Nikesh's novel. You don't say, well, Napoleon's a slightly funny name, I'm going to call him something else, which works better in English.
I don't like it.
But it's about deciding what you think is really important in the book and keeping it. And there is some, I mean, nonfiction is a huge sort of almost meaningless term, but there are some kinds of nonfiction writing where, I mean, the good stuff, essentially, where the prose is important, where the rhythm is important, where the diction is important, which has a very strong sense of voice, which has a very strong sense of pace, and all these things.
Yeah. As much about creating a narrative and creating a story as they are about
talking. I've translated what was essentially a blog made into a book by a Nobel Prize-winning novelist. And the thing that determined how I translated it was not the fact that it happened to be a blog. It was the fact that it was really good writing. Mm. And the words were chosen carefully. Mm. And it wasn't casual. And the point of it was not conveying data. The point of it was something that's happening in this voice. So I think it's quite hard to generalize. I think certainly publishers might consider the editing process different. And in the UK, for various reasons, we translate very little nonfiction. I mean, it's tiny, tiny. It's almost impossible to find any nonfiction in translation for reasons I don't quite understand. But I think it's almost a category error to think of we have rules about fiction and rules about nonfiction. I think we have rules about what's important when you're translating good writing. And then writing which is functional, you care about slightly different things, if that helps.
Do we have time for one more? One more?
Okay, I just like to ask Tamur about this when he was talking about translating.
Mike.
Thank you. I just like to ask Tamur about this when he was talking about Pilsum or Shrubal, which was being translated. And in accordance to the English, I mean to say, if you are reading that novel which is translated, then you have to use the dictionary. And even if you are reading in Urdu, then you have to use the dictionary. What is the matching level when you're translating a classic which is written in 18th century, and then you are going to translate? You are going to use the same sort of an English which was used in 18th century or 19th century. What is the criteria for that?
Well, it's the translator's choice, really. I mean, there are three examples that are, that will illustrate this well. I mean, this is Musharraf Ali Faruqi who translated it. And this is exactly what he did. I mean, I think William Dalrymple reviewed his book, and when he first met William, he was surprised. He thought, oh, I thought you must be some 80-year-old Oxford professor, right? But because of the diction that he's used in his work, he is sort of chosen. I mean, it's quite difficult to read that book without, I mean, unless you're very, very well read in English. Same goes, for example, I mean, Shamsur Rehman Faruqi, who's a wonderful, wonderful Urdu critic, but he just wrote a beautiful novel in which he's writing about from 17th, 18th century. And what he's doing in his novel, that he's using the diction and the idiom and the language of the geographical space and the time period that he's writing about. And nobody else translated it but himself. And what he has done with English, that he has created these things which people, which his editors or which people other elsewhere were like, this is not English, this doesn't work. And he says, well, I'm creating language because that is, and this is possible in such and such. I mean, he's a master of sort of, you know, English literature as well, so he can do those things. So he's using things, constructions and things which are used in 17th, 16th century English or 18th century, depending on what he's trying to do. Similarly, I mean, a brilliant sort of learning example is the Bible, which I think is much, much more beautiful in Urdu than in English. And the Bible in Urdu has been translated by the fathers, I mean, of Urdu literature. Even though they're not named, there's a secret committee which translated it. But it's beautiful, I mean, and it works very, very well. And there are examples like, for example, I mean, you know, there's this line in Song of Solomon that your eyes are like two doves, which in Urdu has been translated into Tumhari aankhein do kabutar hain, right? Which is a beautiful line in Urdu, but if you translate it back into English, it's like your eyes are two pigeons. Now this sounds disgustingly horrible, right? So these are the, but, so for example, I mean, if you read the Song of Solomon, which has been translated Ghazlul Ghazalat in Urdu, or the Book of Proverbs, and if you read the Urdu one, those, you know, you will see that these choices are largely sort of made by the authors, but then a lot of times they decide to sort of remain true to the register, because if a 18th century text is being read in the original in 20th or 21st century, there will be a historical distance. Similarly, that I think one should try to create that historical distance to give it a sense of sort of time and its historicity.
Thank you, Tamur. I could have listened for hours about this kind of tricks to change metaphors. And thank you to you as an audience. It's amazing to be on a panel on translation with people interested in this kind of weird craft we are dealing with every day, and nobody really asks questions, but it's amazing to be here, and thank you to all the panelists and to BCLT and to BC, the Italian embassy that brought me here as well. Thanks a lot.